So anyway, but point is that, oh wow, that was an interesting email that I sent. So point is that check your eyes, okay? If your eyesight is not good, and if you sit behind the computer doing MATLAB, after about 20 minutes, stop looking at the screen, okay? That is really useful so that you don't really hurt your eyes, because I asked him these questions like, is this not going to affect the entire evolution of humankind, yeah, computers, because, so we talked about that type of stuff, so it took a little longer. I thought we would be done within an hour, but it was like 1 hour, 15 minutes or so. And anyway, so I did prepare. So you got the scripts, yeah? And so I'll start with lecture 10, because the end of lecture 9 is actually copy to the start of lecture 10, so it's the same, okay? And Friday, fortunately, we have enough time, so each week we have at least half an hour review section at the end of the week. So let's say, what directory am I in now? Yes, I'm already in the correct directory, you see here, yeah, on top. I'm in directory lecture 10. If I do pwd, you see that this is the directory that I am in. And then I can see what files are in that directory with ls, or these are old, very old DOS commands. I don't know if you know what DOS is, but that's an operating system that when I was a child was working with. And we had these really bad games that we would play from that, and we thought it was fantastic, yeah? But compared to now, it's like really ridiculous, but I still play them so now and then. And they those are games that actually fix on a single, like, they're like 128 kilobytes, yeah? And those are entire games that you bought at that time for like 100 guilders, like $50. So it's amazing how things have changed. Nowadays these games are so way more realistic, yeah? Like Vietnam War, and you just keep shooting and it looks really realistic. Anyway, okay, so today what we'll talk about is matrix vector multiplication. So we talked about element by element multiplication, and that only works in a situation that both vectors or both matrices are of the same size. But many people that use MATLAB are really not interested in those type of calculations. They use MATLAB from matrix algebra. And you've had matrix algebra in high school, probably. I don't know what at least I did, 3 or 4 years. And then at the university. So we'll talk about matrix vector multiplication of a matrix, and I'm multiplying with a vector. Then we'll talk about vector matrix multiplication. So I have a vector that I multiply with a matrix, or the other way around. Then we'll talk about matrix matrix multiplication. So I have two matrices that I multiply with each other. Now, then we talk about special properties of vectors and matrices, like dependence. Like two, if I have two vectors, are they dependent on each other? Remember, we talked about an angle on Monday and an L2 norm, that we know how we can calculate whether two vectors, whether there's an angle between those two vectors. If two vectors have an angle, per definition they are independent. Dependent means, and this is all later, it's all in the script, if you read it, there's lots of text in these scripts, there's only very little calculation. Dependent vectors are those in such a way that you can calculate one vector from the other using a single scalar or adding or something else. You can add two vectors up and you get the third one, which means that the third one is dependent on the first two, and that goes into the direction of the rank of a matrix. If you add each of these vectors and it becomes a matrix, and you can calculate the rank. Null space, matrix rank, matrix determinant, and then special matrices. Okay, and I think today we'll catch probably through 4 or 5, and then we'll have Friday for the last few elements here. And we have time, half an hour at least, to go over. We'll go over everything again, what we discussed this week. Now, Imagine I define some matrix A, and I just define it as a user, okay? And this statement over here is similar if you're a more experienced programmer. If I define, I have a matrix A here, so I'll clear the screen, so I define A, okay? So what I have here is matrix A that has 3 rows, 4 columns. The first row is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So essentially I have all the numbers from 1 through 12. So what this makes you think that somehow you could have created this differently, and you can if you would have done it this way. But this is a little bit more difficult because you probably would have thought, you know what, Jasper, what are you doing? You should do it this way around, because you have 3 rows, 4 vectors. So we have the numbers 1 through 12. We want to arrange them with reshape. 3 rows, 4 vectors. But don't you don't get the same result. Look at this. If I would have done that, then I get this result. And that's why I did it the other way around. I first create 4 rows and then 3 columns, but then I transpose, and then you get identical results. So this is for the MATLAB diehards that are like, that you can do the same as this with this statement over here. Okay, this is just for your information, okay? So now I have a matrix A, and now I create a vector X here. So this is my vector X. Okay, so now I have a matrix A and a vector X. Now I like to do matrix times vector multiplication. So, like for instance, something like this, A times X, and we actually get an answer. That's amazing, yeah? But what is going on here? No one understands what's going on here, yeah? So I have a matrix A that's 3 by 4, and I have a vector X that's 4 by 1. And now I say A times X. I do not do element by element, because we know if we use the dot in between, that MATLAB is going to say, what the heck are you doing? Because A and X are not of the same dimension. So you can never do element by element. So the only, if you want to multiply these two things, with this is a matrix and this is a vector, you need to use the product sign. So now we get a result, but why does this work? Because this is quite random, yeah? Like, why do I get a result? Because if A was of different size and I multiply with X, I would not have gotten a result. Now that goes back to the rules of multiplication. And it is here, matrix vector multiplication. Imagine that we have a matrix A that's of size m by n. So m is the number of rows, n is the number of columns. And we multiply that with a vector that is of size n by 1. Then what we end up with is something here that's of size m by 1. And this is just the rules of matrix algebra. So the dimension n that you see up here, so the n columns of the matrix and the n rows of the vector, those need to be equal. So m times n times n by 1. So matrix vector multiplication will only work if the number of columns of the matrix is equal to the number of rows of the vector. And that's in our case true. Because if you look at, if I define this, A has 3 rows, 4 columns. So the vector needs to have 4 rows, because the matrix has 4 columns. And that's what you see. This vector has 4 rows. So then, if we go back to the rule here, we should end up with something that's of size m by 1. And m was the number of rows of the matrix, yeah? Now, you see that B was A times X, and you see the number of rows of our matrix X, matrix A, was 3. So we end up with something that's 3 by 1. And that's simply this rule. So if I give you a matrix and a vector, then you can only multiply them together if this is true, that the number of columns of the matrix is equal to the number of rows of the vector. Now, this is the multiplication by itself. So that's why it works. If, for instance, my matrix A had 5 columns and my vector had 4 rows, then this multiplication would not have happened. So these are the rules. There's a few rules, and they're always the same for matrix vector multiplication, vector matrix multiplication, and matrix matrix multiplication. There's always similar rules. Okay? So the inner, they also call this the inner dimensions here. They're the inner, here in the middle here. Yeah, and this is outside. For this to happen, the inner dimensions need to be equal. So the number of columns and the number of rows, the number of columns of the matrix and the number of rows of the vector need to be identical. Okay, very good. But now the question is, okay Jasper, we calculated that, but what the heck is MATLAB doing? What is matrix algebra? Now, this calculation would be similar if I write out this. Again, I go back to A and X, because I did A times X. So how is this calculation working? Why do I end up with this? So here, A and X here. So what happens is that matrix algebra, the way it always works is horizontal times vertical. So in this case, we take the first row of A and we multiply it with X. So we have something that we essentially calculate an inner product of the first row of A with X. And that will be our first element of B. So I call that B2 because we already have B, just to show, is that if we do the multiplication, how does that work in practice? We take the first row of the matrix and we multiply that with the vector. And assuming, of course, this needs to be a vertical vector. It needs to be n by 1, not 1 by n. N is the number of rows, 1 is the column number. Then the second element of B, which in this case I called B2, is the second row of A times X. And the third column of B is the second row of A times X. So essentially you're calculating 3 times an inner product, but with a different row of A. So if I now look at B and B2, you see they are identical except that B2 writes it out as a horizontal vector. Okay, I could have avoided that if I would have said, you know, this is 1,1, this is 2,1, and this is 3,1. So now I need to clear B2, otherwise you'll see if you don't do that at home you get an error, and now you see that B2 is also vertical because I specify now that I have one column in B2 and I have 1, 2, 3 different rows. So that's how the matrix algebra works, when you multiply a matrix with a vector. So the number of columns of the matrix needs to equal the number of rows of the vector. Then it doesn't matter, if that is true, it will always work. And then the way it's calculated, it's horizontal times vertical. So each row of the matrix is multiplied with the vector, and that's an inner product, remember? Horizontal times vertical, and that's a single number, and that's what you see here. 3, 7, 11. Now, if you're a little bit more of an expert, and this is in the book, you can do this at home, is that you can also write it this way, where these are our individual x elements, x1, x2, x3, and x4. I think here was an x, a capital X or so. So there might be small errors in my code, which I get out in class. So you might not have the perfect version, but the TA can upload if that's necessary. But you'll probably see them very quickly. And you see that this is also the same calculation for matrix times vector, but I'm not gonna ask you this, but you can study why this is the same as what I did over here. Okay. Now, another example here, yeah? We now have something that's 3 by 4. Yeah? Now, and I have a vector, another vector x that I defined, which again is 4 by 1. So it's the same dimension. So is it going to work in this case with completely different numbers? Yes, because if I apply the rule, then I see that, is it going to work in this case, 8 times x? Yes, ax, because you see that the number of columns of a equals the number of rows of x. So it will always go right. So you, when you multiply a matrix with a vector, make sure that the number of columns of the matrix is equal to the number of rows of the vector. And what you'll get out, it's something that's m times n, that's the size of the matrix, times n by 1. So n are the inner dimension, gives us something that's m by 1. So what you'll get is you end up with something that is of size, the number of rows time of the matrix, times 1. So in this case, 3 by 1. 3 rows, 1 column. Now, we've done a times x. Yeah, in this case, when we changed a and x. So that means we multiply a matrix with a vector. We can also do it the other way around. We can multiply a vector with the matrix. So here, now I have another example, u and a. So what are the rules for this? So we looked at matrix times vector, but now let's forget about that. Now let's multiply a vector with a matrix. So we do it the other way around. What are the rules then? Now that's also what I stated here, is that again, the inner dimensions must be equal. If the vector is of size 1 by m, then the matrix must be m by n, and what I'll end up with is something that's 1 by n. Okay, so 1 times n vector, because a vector is one row, and this, that means you need a horizontal vector a, or a horizontal vector x, doesn't matter. So a 1 by m vector, so that could be anything, any name, times m by n, yeah, the matrix, results in something that's 1 by n. So this multiplication will only work, so matrix vector, number of columns of the matrix needs to equal the number of rows of the vector. In the case of vector matrix, that means that the number of columns of the vector needs to equal the number of rows of the matrix. So it's the other way around. Still the same rule. It's the same rule, but now we talk about the columns of the vector instead of the columns of the matrix. So you just are supposed to know these rules, yeah? And you should have gotten, again, the inner dimensions, m and m are equal. So this should be an m. I copy-pasted this at night, you know that, yeah? So if I define this, is this going to work, u and a? So what was the rule again? The number of columns of the vector needs to equal the number of rows of the matrix. Is that true in this case? That's very spontaneous. Yeah, how many rows does how many columns does our vector have? And how many rows does our matrix have? So does this work according to our, and what should this end up as something that's of size? Yeah, now indeed, so if I do u times a, you see, you end up with something that's 1 by 4. And the same trick applies. Why the heck do I get this? So I have u and I have a. So I do horizontal times vertical. So the first number that I get, the minus 6, is probably equal to minus 3 times 3 plus 2 times 0 plus minus 1 times minus 3. So you have minus 3 times 3 is minus 9 plus 2 times 0 is 0, so minus 9 plus minus 1 times minus 3 is 3. So we get minus 9 plus 3 is minus 6, and that's the first answer. Then we do the second. After we're done with this one, we have the first element there on minus 6, and then we do the second column of our matrix. So we get minus 3 times 2 is minus 6. 2 times 3 is 6, so that is 0. Minus 1 times 7 is minus 7. That's what you see on top. Now, and that's how you keep going. So what you end up with is of something that's of size, in this case, equal to 1 by the number of columns of the matrix. Now, that's also written out here. This is what I just said, is that you again calculate an inner product. Yeah, so we have U, we have A, so we do minus 3, this one minus that, that one times that, plus that one times that, and that's our first answer. Then this one minus times that, that one times that, plus that one times that, and then et cetera. So you end up with these four numbers. So you essentially have horizontal times vertical, horizontal times vertical. So that's four times an inner product, and that's what we did here. The first element of V2, V was the outcome of U times A, vector times matrix, is simply U times the first column of A. And that's an inner product because U is horizontal, A, first column of A, of course, is vertical. Now, and that's how we can compute all this. And so this is what we essentially are doing. So you see that V, I didn't compute, is U times A. You see that V and V2 are the same result. And that's how the calculation goes. This is just simply matrix algebra. Okay, we just apply, MATLAB applies these rules if you use the multiplication sign. Because this likely is not going to work if I do dot by dot. And why? Because U and A are of completely different dimension. So a dot product is not going to work. Now, matrix with matrix multiplication. So we've had so far, we had vector times matrix. So if I have a vector and I multiply it with a matrix, then the rule is that a 1 by m vector times an n by n matrix gives us a 1 by n product. Then we have a matrix vector. That's an m by n matrix times an n by 1 vector gives us an m by 1 vector. So the first two rules, a vector matrix product always gives us a vector. In the case of vector matrix, that's an horizontal vector. In the case of matrix vector, the other way around, that's a vertical vector. That's an m by 1. So I can ask on the quiz a question like, if I do vector matrix product, or I do a matrix vector product, how does the outcome differ? Now, in one way, the first one, vector matrix, that gives you a horizontal vector. Whereas in the second case, matrix times vector gives us a vertical vector, where we have m rows under each other with one column. Now, the last option is matrix-matrix product. Imagine I have two matrices, okay? So imagine that the first matrix is of size n by r. Then I multiply that. Again, the inner dimensions need to be the same of the matrix. So if my first matrix is of size n by r, then I need to multiply that with another matrix that has the same number of rows as the number of columns as the first matrix. So that's an r by n. And what does that give? The r's cancel out. That gives us m by n. The same on top, m by 1, 1 by n, yeah? So, if I have two matrices, then I need to make sure that the number of columns of the first matrix are equal to the number of rows of the second matrix. So if I have an example here, a and b, and I have B. So what we see here is that the number of columns, the n by r, the number of columns of A is equal to the number of rows of B, 3. So this multiplication of A times B should work, and that does work. And what did that result in? M times r times r by n gives us m by n. And that's true, that's 2 by 2. And you can work this out. It's the same as with the vector matrix, matrix vector. You can do this horizontal times vertical, horizontal times vertical. So if we look at that in more detail. So what we do is we take the first row of A and we multiply that with the first column of B. Then we do this, the first row of A, and we multiply that with the second column of B. And that gives us the first two numbers on top. Then we go to the next line and we do the first the second row of A times the first column of B, and the second row of A times the second column of B. And that gives us a 2 by 2. So this is the result for the first row of A, and this is the result of the second row of A. So here, it's all written out. Yeah, if you looked at this at home, it's all written in text. So you don't have to look at the textbook in that sense. So I can do A times B. Okay, and then try at home if you can do B times A. Okay, try that at home and see whether that's possible. Now you can very quickly see yes or no. Just look at the rule. So it's important that you know this rule. Okay? Now, independence, factor dependence, factor independence. We already talked about an inner product, outer product, the angle between two vectors, the moments of a vector, the length of a vector is equal to the length of a vector. Is that an L1 norm, an L2 norm, an L infinity norm, etc. Now the question is, you're a mathematician, and what they always want to know, if I have two vectors, do they lie in the same plane? Not a plane that travels from LAX to Amsterdam, but a subsurface, yeah, and a certain surface. So we have two vectors that I defined here, U and V. Yeah, and they're both vertical vectors, because that's where the prime comes in. So U is of size 3 by 1, and V is of size 3 by 1. So I could do element by element multiplication, because they're both of the same size. But I'm not interested in that, so I could use the dot product. Okay? But that's not the point here. The question is, are these two vectors dependent or independent? What do you think? Are they dependent or independent? Yeah, they are dependent, because you can compute V from U by just multiplying U with a single value that's allowed, a scalar of minus 2. If I multiply U with minus 2, I'm going to get V. So in this case, they are dependent. These are dependent factors. Now, and that's what we will see, because we can actually calculate the cosinus of the, remember, the angle. So U prime, U is a vertical vector, so U prime will make it horizontal. So this is the inner product then. And let's see what we get. The cosinus is minus 1. So what do we know if the cosine of the angle is minus 1? That the angle is 180 degrees. So they're exactly in the opposite direction. Yeah? So they fall basically on a straight line. One is pointing in this direction and the other one is pointing in this direction. So this one is similar to this one if you just multiply with minus 2 in our case. And that's what you can see here. So these two vectors can never be independent, because they have an angle of 180 degrees. Only vectors that have an angle are independent. So here's another example. And this is important, okay? I have three factors here. Should I? I have here. Look at these three factors here. Yeah. These three factors are linearly independent. And why? I cannot simply compute one from the other two vectors. So all these three vectors are independent. The first factor is 4, 0, 0, 0 prime, so it's a vertical vector. They're all vertical vectors of size 4 by 1. The second one is 0, minus 3, 0, 0. And the third one is 0, 0, 1, 0. So you cannot find a simple multiplication or some other type of mathematical by adding two vectors up, like I can add V to W. No matter what I do, I will never be able to get one from the other two, unless I start using four different values that I multiply with. And that's not allowed. You can only subtract, add, or multiply with the scalar for independence. So in this case, you can never derive one factor from the other two vectors by using a single number, by subtracting, or by adding two vectors together. If I add V to W, I will get something that is 0 minus 3, 1, 0. Now, that's not equal to U. Now, there's no type of approach that you can do that. So all these three vectors are linearly independent. And that's simple to figure out. Because you can calculate the angle between this and this vector. We know how to do that now. You can calculate the angle between this and this vector. And you can calculate the angle between W and U. So you can calculate the different angles of the vector. And you will see that that cosine of that angle is never suggesting that there is no angle. So these vectors are all linearly independent. Now another example here. And let's print this in a matrix here. So question is, are these linearly independent or are they linearly dependent? So we can, there's a way in MATLAB to figure this out. By asking for the rank. And it says that the rank is 3. The rank will tell you if vectors are linearly dependent or independent. You just add them in a matrix. What we just did, we had three factors, U2, V2, and W2. And it says that the rank is 3. And the rank will tell you if the vectors in a matrix are linearly dependent or not. They're only linearly independent if the number of factors is equal to the rank. And that's what you see in this case. You see that the rank is 3. And we had 3 factors. So this is what is called full rank. So all these 3 vectors are linearly independent. So maybe let's go back to the... So linearly independent... Okay, so you guys, we will continue here. We need about on Friday. So look at that rank. Prepare yourself for Friday, the end of this script. The end is relatively simple, small things. We will talk further on Friday, and we'll have half an hour to go over the entire chapter again, okay? Where we summarize everything. So good luck.